would he do that? Because he was a man that realized that the world might not be exactly what he wanted. He realized he had to make a choice. In life, sooner or later, we all have to make choices. Think back when you first invited Jesus Christ into your life. And I struggled with that. I was attending a little Baptist church. It was a long story how I got to this church. Real crazy series of events. But anyway, I met this minister, Reverend Russell Hunt. He came to visit me, and he showed me the love of Christ. His testimony. There was something different about his life. And you know, that's how you really influence another person, by your Christian walk. We had many a conversation. His church prayed for me as a prayer request for 13 months. Not by name, but Pastor Hunt said, there's a young man I'm having conversation and visiting with, and he's struggling, really struggling about spirituality and what to do in Christ. Would you pray for him? 13 months passed, and I was in his office, and he finally said to me, he's my dad's age, and he said, Bob, we've been kind of beating around the bush here for a long time. When are you going to just say yes to Jesus? And I said, oh yeah, everything's going to be hunky-dory, everything's going to be great. And I said, you know, Reverend Hunt, it's easier for you, a minister, to talk about how good life is, but you don't have to live my life. You church people, you live in this little utopia, and I'm in the real world struggling what to do with my life. And I don't have this wonderful family and everything that you have. What am I supposed to do? And I said, so let me hear your answers, preacher. He looked at me and said, you know what? I'm tired of your belly aching. All you do is feel sorry for yourself. You're the biggest complainer I've ever counseled with. What is wrong with you? Why don't you just accept the Lord? What do you want, the world handed to you in a platter? I said, how dare you talk to me that way? He said, I'm talking like I talk to my own children. The man wanted to be your father. I said, I'm aware of that. That's true. He said, what do you want? I said, you know what I want? No more of your so-called church stuff. I'm out of here, pal. And I took off. I slammed the door of his office, and I ended up 10 foot of rubber in front of that church. And I thought, the nerve of that man to tell me off like that. He's supposed to be nice. He wasn't nice at all. He talked to me like my father would talk to me, yell at me. Went home that night and thought it over, picked up my Bible, and I started reading again. And through that process of the next hour, 2 hours, I began to realize something. He was right. And I knelt by my bed and I said, Lord, I am sorry. Every day I would say this silly prayer, Lord, change the world, make it a better place, and bless me. And then I realized that wasn't going to happen. You know what I realized? The world was not going to change the world, but I would. And so I said, Lord, I don't understand Christianity. I don't understand the Bible. But I do know one thing. I want you to be my Savior. I can't tell you the date like some people can. It's about a year, maybe 6 months before I met my wife. The Lord had it all worked out. I was bad enough, my wife met me. She couldn't meet the pre-Christian woman. It would have been terrible. But that morning when I got up, walked down my door with a sunny day like today, I looked up in the sky and I said, Lord, I know the world's still the same, but I'm going to look at it differently. And I'll never walk alone. And I've never walked alone since Christ been my Savior. And all of a sudden, you start to realize it's got to be God's way and not my way or your way. I've often wondered, though, and this may sound silly, is it easier for women to become a Christian than men? I think the stubbornness in men make it rather difficult. 13 months to pray for me. I called Reverend Hunt up and I said, Reverend Hunt, this is Bob Ralph. Oh, really? I thought you were never going to talk to me again. I thought you were mad at me. You told me to take a hike. I said, whoa, let me back off. I have to see you. So I went over there. He said, well, what's up? Same old story again, complaining about the war. I said, hey, give me a break. He said, well, if you give the Lord a break, I'll give you a break. And I said, I've been wrong. I've been looking at this whole thing wrong. Let me tell you what happened to me last night in my house. And with that, he said, praise the Lord. A couple weeks later, I went to his church and they let me share my testimony on a Sunday morning. And he said, This is the man whose name I never gave you. He's the man I've been praying for. My life has never been quite the same since, but I still struggle with choices. Many times we hear sermons that in evangelism campaigns, how you become a Christian. But a lot of times we need to hear messages, what do we do once we become a Christian? It's easy to get stagnant. You can say, I became a Christian on October 4th, that's made the date, 1958. Well, that's nice, that's a point in time, but what have you been doing since? Moses had to make a decision. He chose authenticity over prestige. And in this verse, when he grew up, he said, I'm not going to be the son of Pharaoh's daughter. I'm going to give that away. I want something more in life. And ultimately, we have to make that decision. What are we going to do with our relationship with Jesus Christ? We just can't go through life, you know, playing a game with him. We have to really settle the question. In other words, what do you want? Prestige, things of the world? Or do you want an authentic relationship with Jesus Christ? But I'll tell you something. Living in this world today is difficult. There's a lot of things buying our time. They really are. And many times we make a decision. Have you ever done this and said this? What's in it for me? Have you ever done that? We all do. I've done it. Maybe I'm the only one that's done it. I don't think so. We have to make a shift from what's in it for me, from does